Hey everyone, I trust that everyone had a good night's sleep, and welcome back to day two of our National Conservative Student Conference. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Ross Dubberly. I am the co-founder and co-chairman of YAF at the University of Georgia, and I am looking forward to a great weekend with all of you guys. But this morning, I have the great honor and privilege to introduce Dennis Prager. I must confess that I'm a huge fan of Mr. Prager's work for two big reasons. Number one, without his show, I would not have found this distinct organization, Young America's Foundation, which I have had the privilege to intern for this summer. And number two, because I believe Mr. Prager provides something very important, something very unique, and something lacking for most of our policy discourse today, and that's moral clarity. Dennis Prager is the host of the widely popular and influential talk show, The Dennis Prager Show, which can be heard 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. Pacific. He can also be seen regularly on CNN and Fox News. In addition, his daily radio show, Mr. Prager lectures frequently on various topics from religion to politics. Mr. Prager is also a prolific commentator, writing a weekly column that appears in townhall.com, National Review, among other places. His writings have also been featured in the Weekly Standard and the Wall Street Journal. Mr. Prager is the author of six books, The Nine Questions People Ask About Judaism, which is the most widely used introduction to Judaism in the world. Number two, Why the Jews, The Reason for Anti-Semitism, Think a Second Time, Happiness is a Serious Problem, Still the Best Hope, Why the World Needs American Values to Triumph, which I highly recommend, and also the Ten Commandments, Still the Best Moral Code. Mr. Prager has also produced three films and is currently in the process of producing a fourth, No Safe Spaces, which he'll be producing with comedian and filmmaker Adam Carolla. Prager was a fellow at Columbia University's School of International Affairs, where he did graduate work at the Middle East and Russian Institute. He has taught Russian and Jewish history at Brooklyn College, and President Ronald Reagan appointed him to the U.S. delegation to the Vienna Review, Conference on the Helsinki Accords. He also received an honorary doctorate of law from Pepperdine University. Mr. Prager also periodically conducts orchestras and has introduced hundreds of thousands of people to classical music. In 2011, Mr. Prager co-founded Prager University with his producer, Alan Estrin, which is an institution of higher learning on the internet with a unique difference. All of the courses are 5 minutes long. The courses distill the best ideas of the best minds in the world and cover the disciplines of political science, history, philosophy and religion, economics and psychology. And the faculty includes Paul Johnson, George Gilder, Arthur Brooks, and Peter Kreeft, and many others. And by the end of the year, I'm pleased to report, PragerU will have over 400 million views. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dennis Prager.
Hi, everybody. It's wonderful to be back. Thank you, Ross, for the meaningful words. I will just tell you that introducing is not as easy as it seems. At the University of Colorado in Boulder many years ago, a young woman, a student there, introduced me, and she announced this is the first time that she was ever publicly speaking, which became apparent momentarily. And so she read, all she had to do really was read from this script that's provided, but she was quite nervous, and it said that the actual words were, the Los Angeles Times said that Mr. Prager is preoccupied with good and evil. And she read it, the Los Angeles Times said that Mr. Prager is preoccupied with doing evil. And I remember my first thought was, how does she know? No. Be that as it may, it really is great to be here, despite the fact that it is 6 a.m. for me. I came in from California last night. Wow. Hey, If that's an achievement in your eyes, I'm in good shape. That's really great. By the way, just by clapping, how many of you have seen two or more videos of Prager University? Okay. All right. Well, that's very important to me, as you well know. So I really take this seriously, obviously, or I wouldn't cross the country and then go. I'm going back today because I consider this so significant. I thought, what can I talk to you about in the 45 minutes plus questions that I have? And I thought, you know what? I'm going to not talk about politics as such. I'm going to talk about what I like to call on my radio show the ultimate issues. So I'm going to give you, it all has political ramifications, but I'd like to give you about five or six points of ideas that have animated my life and that I have learned in my much longer life than yours. And so here they go. It's not an order of importance. They're all very important. And I could give you another six and another six and another six, because it's the purpose of adults to tell young people what they've learned. Otherwise, what's the point of getting older? Right? I mean, and by the way, there's proof to that. Let's say you're 20. Every one of you knows how much more you know now about life than you did at 15. So double that. How much more will you know at 40? So there's a certain inevitability, but not entirely, because there are people who get older and stay stupid. And I don't mean to put them down. Well, actually, I do. There's something wrong in not growing, but that's another subject. Number one, and oddly enough, it might be the most important single thing, because if you don't know this, I don't think wisdom is possible. That's how much weight I place on this realization. And I know that if you don't agree, it will be painful to hear. But you're not snowflakes. So I'm prepared to say something that you may not have thought about or even thought about and come to a different conclusion. And that is, people are not basically good. If you don't know that, I do not believe wisdom is possible, and I don't believe it is possible to make a better world. It is the great myth of the post-Enlightenment Western secular world that human nature is good. Human nature is not good. It's not evil. If it was purely evil, no good would be done. There are good people. Of course there are good people. In fact, my life has been dedicated to the question, how do you make good people? There is no more important question in society. Every other question is secondary to the question of how do you make people good? Because we don't start out good. People who tell me babies are good have it wrong. Babies are innocent, but they're not good. No baby has altruism. Gee, you know, I've been puking and crapping and peeing for the last week. My parents really need some time together. So I'm just going to stop crying tonight, let them go out and enjoy each other, and then I'll resume crying when they get back. This does not occur to a baby. By the way, if we were not completely self-absorbed as a baby, we wouldn't survive. I'm not anti-baby, just for the record. I was a baby, and I had a very good image of myself as a baby. So this is not an issue. Please understand, though, we're not good. There was no parent that I have ever met who looked at their kid and said, you know, you share too much. Any of you ever told that by your parents? You just share too much. Learn to be more selfish. It doesn't happen. How many times did your parents say to you, say thank you? Was it 4,000, 10,000? Why didn't it work once? If we're basically good, oh, of course I should say thank you. But you're not basically good. So you have to be told over and over the unbelievably elementary moral decency of thanking someone for doing something good for you. Even that doesn't come naturally. It is the grand lie of the secular world since the Enlightenment that people are basically good, and so much damage has been done by that. For example, one of the biggest is, do you blame people for the evil they do, or do you blame external sources? If a person rapes, murders, mugs, embezzles, robs a store, burns down a store, do you say they have done evil or they are victims of bad parenting, of racism, of poverty? That's what I was taught. Poverty causes crime. Who believes poverty causes crime? People who believe people are basically good, so they don't blame the criminal. They blame poverty. The first time I heard poverty causes crime, I knew it was wrong because I thought of my grandparents who were in New York during the Depression, not just the Depression, but unemployed. They were quintessentially poor. And then I thought, how come my grandfather never mugged anybody? No, isn't that a logical question? If poverty causes crime, my grandfather should have been a criminal. But he wasn't, because he had religion, because he believed that there is a God who says, do not steal. That's why. It's a big reason. But because we believe this idiocy that people are basically good, we have dispensed with religious morality. Oh, I don't need the Ten Commandments. I'm so good. People don't need to be told by a God. It's mucked. You know, we have 400 million views a year at Prager University videos. You know the ones that get the most mocked? Not on healthcare, not on taxes, and we get a lot of criticism on those. The ones that say God is necessary. This drives people crazy because we live in an utterly secular world which believes God can be dispensed with morally and existentially and so on. I'll get to that in the next topic. One more thing. I don't excuse adults who believe people are basically good. I excuse kids because it's a nice fantasy and kids believe in fantasies. But for an adult to know the human record and to argue people are basically good? Do they not know about the utter universality of slavery, just as an example? Utterly universal. There is not a society in history that we know of that did not have slavery. If people were basically good, why would it have been so ubiquitous? Not to mention torture and rape and murder. And to say this after World War II, people are basically good? You really have to suspend judgment. It's wishful thinking. And for one final thing, I don't even wish it. And I'll tell you why. Because I know that people aren't basically good. I am so happy every time I meet a good person. I'm never disappointed when I meet a bad person. I don't expect much from humans. Therefore, when I meet a good person, I've always said, you know what my biggest hobby is? Good people collecting. That's what I do. I collect good people. And it's one of the reasons for my energy and my happiness in life. Number two, the necessity of God. Necessity. I am not talking about existence. This is not a talk right now about whether or not God exists. I do believe God exists. That's a separate issue. I am now not talking, people can argue whether or not God exists. What is not arguable is whether God is necessary. There is a piece in today's, I think the guy wrote it knowing I'm going to speak to you. I'm going to write them a note and thank them for publishing this. Some professor wrote a piece today. I don't know, I think he's a physicist. I didn't check. But he studies the universe, and he realizes everything ends. There's no intrinsic meaning to the universe. It's all meaningless. You better make up something or you'll go crazy. That's what existentialism is. You can't stare in the mirror and go, how you doing, you meaningless bunch of molecules? Nobody can do, you can't do that. It's too painful. So people make up meanings. Career, love, family, kids, travel, hobbies, and otherwise they'll go nuts. And by the way, all of that is great. I'm totally into all of those things. But it's made up. In fact, without a God, it is a material universe. All that is real is matter, and therefore life is ultimately meaningless. If you deny that, you are fooling yourself. Maybe it's good to fool yourself so that you have a happier day. But in fact, that's the case. Even if God doesn't exist, I'm not talking about existence, I'm talking about necessity. No God, no ultimate meaning. No God, everything ends when we die, everything. There is no afterlife, you see no one you have loved, everything that has been done, you've done, will be forgotten. There's probably no one or maybe three people in this room who could even name a great-great-grandparent, let alone knows a damn thing about them. So don't give me this nonsense, we live on through the memories of our loved ones, except our loved ones also die. So the memories of you die. You couldn't name three people who lived in the 13th century. Who just name you couldn't do. So let's be honest, it's all forgotten. Everything you do, it's gone, it's a puff. But if there is a God, it's not all over. Now you could say that's wishful thinking too. Fine, I told you, that's an invite me back for just God's existence talk. This is not a God's existence talk, it's a God necessity talk. Only if there is a God is there ultimate purpose to life. Only if there is a God does death not end everything. Only if there is a God is there ultimate justice. People who smashed babies' heads with bayonets in World War II, if there is no God, they simply slinked into the population in which they lived and nothing happened to them. And that nothing is done for the baby. It's all over. Tough kid, that's the way the cookie crumbles. That's the secular view of ultimate justice. That's the way the cookie crumbles. But if there is a God, there is ultimate justice. That's a big difference if there's a God or not. And if there is a God, there is absolute or objective morality. Evil exists, actually evil. Just like 2 and 2 is 4, murder is wrong. Without God, all ethics are subjective. That's just the way it is. It doesn't mean you can't be a good atheist. There are kind atheists. There are despicable religious people. That's a given. But it has nothing to do with the point. The point is good and evil do not exist objectively if there is no God. See the video that we put out, if there is no God, why is murder wrong? Or is murder wrong? Not why. Is murder wrong? There is an aimlessness in Western society because it has become it's the first secular society in human history. Western Europe is the first godless society in the history of the world. And if the left has its way in the United States, we will follow because they look at Europe as a model. And let me tell you, you know what the biggest problem in Europe is? And there are a lot of problems in Europe, but I think the biggest one is the big B, boredom. Because ultimately, they don't believe in their nations, and they don't believe in a religion. They believe in more free hours not to work. That's what has become the great crusade in Europe. How could I work fewer hours? Number 3, race is irrelevant. Irrelevant. If you believe race matters, you're a racist. By definition, that is the definition of racism, that the color of your skin determines something about you. We live in the antithesis of the liberalism that I grew up with. Leftism is anti-liberal. If you understand that, you know 50% of what you need to know about leftism. Leftism has nothing in common with liberalism. I grew up a liberal, how could I not? I'm a Jew from New York. So obviously, I grew up as a liberal. On my birth certificate, it had liberal. It was the single most important item on the birth certificate. So I understand that. And as a liberal, I understood to be race blind is the ideal. Character matters, not skin color. The left is the first, the American and Western left, is the first ideology since the Nazis to say race is important. I'm not comparing them to Nazis. The Nazis are uniquely evil. I'm merely stating a fact, not an opinion. Between Nazism and contemporary leftism, no one held race was important. No one. Only racists, neo-Nazis, and now the Washington Post, New York Times, and every college you go to. They believe race is important. But the University of California has issued a list of microaggressions. You all know what microaggressions are, right? Here is an example of a racist microaggression, a statement people make thinking it's nice, but it's really, get it, racist. If you say there is only one race, the human race, you are a racist, according to the left-wing leaders of the University of California. Check it, folks, check it. My credibility rides on every comment I make. I know that. I'm very careful before God and man never to exaggerate. That is listed as a statement of racism, to say there is only one race, the human race. So you are saturated in an utterly racist environment at almost any university you attend, but with black dorms and Hispanic graduations. That's all pure racism. No liberal in American history would have countenanced it. If you had told John F. Kennedy that Harvard will have a separate graduation for blacks, he would have said it is not possible because it's a liberal institution. And he was right. Liberal institutions don't have black graduations. Leftist institutions have black graduations. Number four, and I guess what I'm doing here is sort of slaughtering a lot of sacred cows. I didn't think of the talk as such, but it's really what I guess it's come to. Feminism has done a lot of damage. People always ask me, well, hasn't it done some good? Of course it's done some good. Can you name anything that has not done any good? It's an absurd question, did it do any good? We don't judge people or ideas by did it do any good. We judge them on the sum total. Is the sum total good or not good? The sum total of feminism has been a moral and personal disaster for the society. But it has done some good. First of all, any decent human knows or must know humans are equal. There is no egalitarian difference between men and women. It's so obvious that, I mean, I don't know. I don't think I was a particularly quote unquote progressive. I grew up in a normal home, and the idea that my father was more valuable than my mother as a human being, it would have struck me as a moron. Only a moron would say that, or that in general men are more important than women. There were people who believed it in history. I know that, but it's a given that is wrong. But beyond that, what feminism has done has hurt people terribly. It's hurt women and it's hurt men. I ask almost every woman 25 years or younger. Sometimes I get it wrong. Sometimes they're 32 and they look 25, but they're not insulted when I tell them, oh, I thought you were 25. Anyway, I really do. I ask a waitress, a flight attendant, somebody I'm sitting next to on the plane, I talk to strangers. It's one of my favorite things in life. It's one of my top 10 things. If I don't make people in an elevator laugh, I feel I have failed my day. So I just, this is my nature. So I will ask someone, if she's a woman under 25, I ask this question. And I say, listen, there's no right or wrong answer. So just be honest with me, and here's the question. And every woman here should consider this. If you could be guaranteed a great career or a great marriage, which guarantee would you take? Now remember, if you take guarantee A, it doesn't mean B cannot happen. It just means only one of them is guaranteed. Okay, this is not rocket science, so I explain that. And here is what happens. A lot of young women will think a great deal, wow, I never thought of that, which in and of itself blows my mind. You never thought of that? What the hell is more important than that? You never thought What's more important to me in the final analysis, a great career or a great marriage? What have you been thinking about if that's not what you've been thinking about? Have you been thinking, healthcare? Has that been on your mind all that time? That's quite a, you do belong in Washington. But I don't get it when they say, oh, I haven't thought about it. I'm just amazed. That never would have been an answer to your grandmothers. Never. Or great-grandmother, or great-great-grandmother, or great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandmother back to Eve. This is new. This is a feminist invention that you don't even think about it. Or that you answer, well, great career, which is about 50% of the time. Great career. So let me tell you something. Doing a talk show with millions of listeners, doing a talk show for 35 years, and I talk about these things just as much as I do what's happening in the news. And so it's been fascinating, all the women in their 50s and older who have called in, and I've said, if you pursued a career rather than marriage and you've had a successful career, if you didn't have a successful career, obviously, it won't apply. Call me and tell me how you look back on this issue. And the recordings of these women should really be played for every young woman. Well, Dennis, the truth is, I make a good six-figure income, well into the six figures. I'm a very successful CEO at a company. And I bought the feminist line when I was in college, and I vigorously pursued a career. I said, I could always find a guy. If he comes around, fine. That's what, by the way, that's a very common thing. Oh, yeah, no, well, if he comes around, if I meet a right guy, I'll have a comment to say about that in a moment. And I'll have a comment to say about the men, too, if the women think I'm picking on them. I'm not picking on you. I'm helping you. And they will say they just feel they, sure, so they had a very successful day at the office. They're a CEO, and they go back to their home, and there's no family. There's no man, there's no kids. And now, of course, someone would say, well, I don't need a man to have kids, which is part of a big problem in society. It is. It's a very serious problem. And not that there aren't wonderful single mothers, but it's a very bad idea to think, oh, I don't need to get married. I could have kids without a man. Yes, it's physically possible, but there's no comparison. If it happens and you can't help it through divorce, through widowhood, through breakup, through whatever it is, okay, I understand. But to plan on that is not a wise thing. It's not, career does not do, and this is what you will never be told, because this is the biggest problem of feminism. It taught that men and women are basically the same, which is as big a lie as people are basically good. We are not basically the same. We are profoundly different. And I hate to use the word lie. Lie is really as bad a word as I could use before an obscenity. I try to say mistake, error, but this was a lie because it was deliberately done. Of course, men and women are profoundly different. We even know now their brains are different. We're profoundly different. But feminism taught we're the same, and it sold a terrible bill of goods to women. Oh, just like men can get so much meaning out of life from a career, so could I. But most women are not built that way. Some women are as driven for career through a life as men are, but most are not. That's not their nature. Just isn't, which is a good thing. You don't want both driven by the exact same things. It's probably not the way it was designed. I think by God, if you like evolution, whatever, and I'm not saying evolution didn't occur. All I'm saying is I don't believe it designed everything about us, which is what is currently taught to you, the evolutionary explanation for bubblegum. Why did we love bubblegum? Well, just evolutionarily, we could see it really was better. Those who chewed bubblegum did better in the final analysis and survived longer. There's an evolutionary explanation for everything. We're not basically the same. We're very different. Sexually, girls in my generation, I remember, I'm very open. I decided very early in my life to hide virtually nothing and let the chips fall where they may. It has been advantageous. It's not always easy. But when I was in college and graduate school, feminism was in its heyday, just total heyday. Late 60s, early 70s, and I remember that the idea became quite popular among girls my age that, hey, we can have sex just as meaninglessly as men can. And I thought, wow, does God love me or what? Men have been waiting to hear that for 26,000 years. And I was born into the first generation that believed that. Because I've always been very morally concerned, and I never wanted to fool anyone or use anybody. But if women were now saying, hey, it's wonderful having relations without any meaning, who am I gonna argue with them? And so that was what happened. And I knew, God, it's not true, but that was what people believed. And that's why there were so many more women in college who were depressed than men. I mean, this is from the New York Times, which hails feminism. How many more women are suffering from depression in college? And this is a big part of the reason. Because now I'm not saying there were no women. I'm talking generalizations, like seatbelts save lives. Can you point to a person who died because they wore a seatbelt? Yes, some people die because they wear a seatbelt in a crash. They can't get out of the belt and they burn alive in the fire. But overwhelmingly, seatbelts save lives. Overwhelmingly, sex is not the same thing for both sexes. That's just the way it is. And but you're not, if you're told that, you know, the person who tells you that, it probably can't even get tenure or even hired as a teacher at a college. So these are things to think about. And I only had sons. It's just the way it works. My father had two sons. I have two sons. My son has two sons. It's a two-son world that I come from. So, but if I had a daughter, you know, I would tell her, if you meet a wonderful guy in 21 or 20, don't let him go. Great guys don't grow on trees. Okay? And to the guys, you won't grow up till you marry. Now, that may not matter to most of guys your age. They don't want to grow up. Growing up, hey, I'm from the baby boomer generation, the ultimate Peter Pans. My generation said, don't trust anyone over 30. They didn't want to grow up. It really bothered a lot of my generation. Growing up, that's a horror. They couldn't, the thought just frightened them. That's why they never wanted to be called Mr. by kids. Wanted to be called by their first name by kids because they wanted to be on the kids' level. I don't want to be regarded as an adult. Oof. And so that's what happened. You want to grow up? Get married. You meet a great girl. What is this? This, by the way, let me tell you guys, utter nonsense, statistically and logically. Well, I'll get married as soon as I'm financially stable. Why can't you become financially stable along with a wife? I don't quite understand. Is she a burden on your financial stability? Do you know every piece of data shows that men who marry make more money, not less? Because they don't spend as much time as sports bars, where the earnings potential is minimal. Oh, I now have a wife, and maybe kids will be coming. I have to support somebody. That's great. You grow up that way. There isn't a human alive who I have ever met, even if they had a horrible divorce, who denies that marriage made them better. Marriage grew them up. That's just a rule of life. Because until then, the biggest preoccupation of your life is you. And you don't grow up when you are the center of your life. There are many wonderful single people, I'm not an idiot, I know that, who devote their lives even to helping others, and that's beautiful. But that's a macro. On the micro level, marriage makes you a man or a woman. Until then, by and large, you're a girl or a boy. That's the truth, Ruth. But who's going to tell you that? Your professor of gender studies? What am I up to? Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Okay. This is a biggie. Behavior is everything. Feelings are nothing. How you feel is important to the following human beings: you, your mother, and your therapist. There are 7 billion other people in the world, not one of whom cares about your feelings, all of whom care about your behavior. Okay? If the waiter or waitress is in a bad mood because something sad happened in their day, I feel for them, but I don't care. I expect nice behavior as if it's a great day for that waiter or waitress. That is the way life works. I wrote a book on happiness. It's selling now since 1999 rather well because this is one of its points. You should act, this is my whole thesis, not my whole, but it's the biggest part of my thesis on happiness. Act happy even if you do not feel it. Because A, you owe it to everyone in your life not to inflict a bad mood on them. Inflicting bad moods is like inflicting bad body odor. You shower every day, not because it is hygienically or medically necessary, but so that you can offer a sweet-smelling body and a sweet-smelling mouth through toothbrushing to all those you meet. That's the reason. Just as you brush away bad breath, you have to brush away bad moods. That's the way it is. You have no right to inflict your bad mood on anyone in your life. Not your coworker, not your roommate, not your friend, not your husband, not your wife, not your parents, not your children. Children who grow up with unhappy parents should all have a memoir that is required reading by other people. The burden it is to be married to a chronically unhappy person. These are things that are not spoken about. Everybody has sadness in their life. If you live, you have sadness. That's the way it is. As Dostoevsky wrote, to live is to suffer. It's a somewhat of exaggeration, but he was Russian after all. But for most people, it is absolutely true. Life is filled. Now, for some more than others, obviously. Not everybody suffers equally, but everybody has pain. It's not possible to go through life without pain. So the question is, how do you deal with it? And it can't be on the basis of mood. You owe it. It's a moral obligation. That's how I teach happiness on my show. I have an hour on happiness every week, also since 1999. And I tell people you have a moral obligation to everyone in your life to act as happy as possible. So when I talk to people, especially young people like you, I get a very common question, so I'll try to answer it now, and we can have new questions afterwards. And that is, well, that's inauthentic, which I always find a very interesting argument. It is inauthentic to act happy if you aren't happy. Since when is authenticity so great? Bad breath is authentic. That's my whole point, okay? I won't even tell you what else is authentic because I don't want to get gross. But there is a lot that is authentic that you cover up. It's not an end in itself. You're not false. By acting happy, you don't have to say to someone, are you happy? You could totally say, hey, listen, I know I come across as happy because I owe it to people, but I have a lot of pain in my life. I don't want you to deny that. That's a perfectly legitimate statement to make. You don't have to hide how you feel. You have to act differently than you feel. I learned this in fourth grade in yeshiva. Yeshiva is Orthodox Jewish school where half the day is in Hebrew of religious studies and half day is in English secular studies. So I was immersed in these studies till the age of 18. Fourth grade, the rabbi announces boys, because only boys are obligated to ritual laws by and large in Judaism. So he says, boys, it's time for the afternoon prayer. And I walked over to him, because I always had chutzpah. I never had disrespect, but I always had chutzpah, audacity. And I very sincerely walked over and said, Rabbi, forgive me, I'm not in the mood for the afternoon prayer. And I'll never forget, it's the only memory I have from fourth grade, is the rabbi's reaction. If I had said, Abba Dabba Dabba Woo, he would have reacted very similarly. He had never heard the word mood and prayer in the same sentence in his life. this was new. He knew you're obligated, there's an obligation. There's an afternoon prayer time, you do it. So he thought and he thought, he looked up, he stroked his beard, and then he finally said, Dennis Prager is not in the mood for the afternoon prayer? So what? The man changed my life with that response. All of a sudden, my mood was insignificant. My behavior was everything. This is life-changing, life-changing. I'm not in the mood is irrelevant, irrelevant. You do what is right, then you get in the mood. Act. Actions affect mood more than mood should ever be allowed to affect actions. Act happy, you'll be happy. That's how it works. I am a total behaviorist. Act X, you'll feel X. This is a big deal because in our society, it's a big deal, first of all, because so many people are told that their mood is and their feelings are what matter, and they don't, you know, I feel, so what? It's like when my older son was 2, this actually happened in a park in LA, a 5-year-old boy came over and threw him on the ground. Just like that, this terrible bully kid came over. The mother saw what her son did, ran over to him, and said, honey, what's troubling you? Honey, what's troubling you? Who cares? What troubles me is that you threw down a little kid. You are in big trouble, man. You're in big trouble. You don't do that. But she was preoccupied because she probably went to graduate school. She, because that's where you learn to be stupid. I mean that. I'm sorry to say it. I do mean it. If a person has a PhD in the social sciences, I assume they're not wise. There are some exceptions, but not many. The more you attend college, the greater the level of your non-wisdom. It's a sad fact. That woman, no woman in history did that. Mothers who saw their child throw down a toddler, smack the kid, spank the kid, or grab the kid, yelled at the kid, punished the kid, but did not say, what's troubling you? You have to learn something that injurious and foolish, and it's learned at college. Where else? How do you feel? It's not, everything is how do you act. By the way, there's a left-right difference on this. The left is tremendously preoccupied with feelings. That's why, what is the key word in policy for the left? Compassion. Compassion is a feeling. Compassion has nothing to do with wisdom. Compassion is a feeling. If you don't ever have compassion, you're a monster. We all know that. But compassion is not a way to make policy. Compassion is a feeling. So you have compassion for people, you raise the minimum wage to $15. However, more people are thrown out of work and more businesses go out of business. But it doesn't matter because you meant well. For the left, meaning well is everything. That's why they call conservatives bad names. Six herb, sexist, intolerant, xenophobic, homophobic, Islamophobic, racist, and bigoted. Because they know they are pure. So if you oppose pure people, you are impure. That's the reason they have one-word dismissals for conservative positions. They don't argue with us. They dismiss us as sexist, intolerant, xenophobic, homophobic, Islamophobic, racist, and bigoted. That is the way. That is the way they preserve their self-image as wonderful people. I feel good about myself. And I will end with this. So I guess it's number 7? 6. The self-esteem movement is another bad idea. And I can prove it to you in a minute. And then I want to take your questions. So here it goes. First, I'd like you to think of any adult, an aunt, an uncle, a parent, a friend of your parents, any adult in your life that you admire for their goodness, for their kindness, for their nobility. I trust you have someone like that. I'm not sure you do, but I trust you do. And I'd like you to ask them one question. When you were a kid, did you have high self-esteem? I am willing to bet, and I am not a gambler, I'm willing to bet 99% of those responses will be, are you kidding? I didn't have high self-esteem as a kid. You know who have high self-esteem, though? Guess, this will shock you, murderers. Roy Baumeister is one of the leading criminologists in the country, and he's written books on this. I've had him on my show. He lives, in a sense, his work is with violent criminals. They have the highest self-esteem that he has ever encountered in any other person in the country. Okay? Self-esteem is another stupid, dangerous idea that our dear fellow members of the left came up with. And they do have high self-esteem because they think they're wonderful, and therefore their opponents are sexist, intolerant, xenophobic, homophobic, Islamophobic, racist, and bigoted. They're wonderful. Don't raise your kids with high self-esteem. Raise them with earned self-esteem. When I saw that my kid got a trophy after his team came in last in baseball, I couldn't believe it. And I remember asking him, David, your team came in last. Why did you get a trophy? And with utter sincerity, he said, for playing. You get a trophy for playing? That's mind-boggling. Do you get a trophy for breathing? There should be a breathing trophy. It would be as meaningful as a playing trophy. This is part of the nonsense. You have grown up in a sea of nonsense. And I have tried to show you how to get out of that sea. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Thank you again. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. 23 of you did not stand, and I'd like to see you afterwards. Okay, by the way, I do want to remind all of you who don't know, Prager University puts out a video every week. We'll have a half a billion views this year, and it's changing minds. That's what we want to do with. So if you want the depth you don't get at college 5 minutes at a time, please just go on the list to be notified every week of a PragerU video. Okay, shall we just go alternate here, please? You want to say where you're from? Thank you.
Yeah.
Is the mic on? Okay.
Hello. Hey. My name is Hayden, and I'm from Fullerton City College. And my question is, in a recent column, you mentioned that you believe America is in a second civil war. Can you expand on that?
Yeah. I was thinking of speaking on that today, but I really didn't want to do pure politics with you. That's not pure politics either. So I did write a column. I have a syndicated column, and I wrote it a few weeks ago. Your next speaker was kind enough to mention it quite a number of times on TV, Newt Gingrich, and it is that we are in a second civil war. It's not over slavery, obviously, but the differences between, and thank God it's thus far relatively nonviolent, and I pray it continues, but the differences between left and right are not bridgeable. The left basically has contempt for the American experiment. It does. That's why Barack Obama said 5 days before he was elected in 2008, in 5 days we will fundamentally transform the United States of America. The left has wanted, since its inception, to fundamentally transform the United States of America. And the right doesn't want to fundamentally transform it. Improve it, fine. But the basic ideas, which are found on every coin, what I call the American Trinity, liberty and God we trust, e pluribus unum, they want to undo all of them. They want to substitute equality for liberty. They want to make the society as godless as possible, and in God we trust. And they believe in multiculturalism as opposed to e pluribus unum. E pluribus unum means from many one. They believe from many, many, that we should be celebrating our ethnic roots rather than our American identity that we share. And that's, on any issue I could show you the unbridgeable divide, but you are fooling yourself if you think there's some happy middle. There isn't. Either the left wins, as it is in Western Europe, and transforms it, or they lose. And we retain the original American ideals of limited government, liberty, of just this alone. The American ideal is I take care of me. My first obligation is to take care of myself. My second is to take care of my family. My third is to take care of my community. The left believes I have no obligation to take care of myself. The society will take care of me. That is so fundamental a difference as to be unbridgeable. That is the way Europeans think. I will be taken care of. I breathe, therefore I am taken care of. That is the left-wing ideal. I am not mocking. I am describing. From birth to death, see the film they showed at the Democratic Convention 8 years ago. I was there at the convention. Of Julia, of a prototypical American female, and how the government takes care of her and her child her entire life. There is no husband, there is no father, nothing. She is taken care of by the state. That's the left-wing dream. The right-wing or American dream is, I take care of me and then of you. And in the rarest of instances when that cannot suffice, the state must step in. Everyone on the right acknowledges that.
Thank you.
Yep.
Hi, my name is Doyle. I'm from Georgia, and I go to Hillsdale College. Even though the Republicans are part of the pro-Israel party that keep losing to Jewish voters, as a politically conservative Jew, what do you suggest for Republicans to win a greater share of the Jewish vote?
There's nothing that, there's really nothing. I'm very involved in Jewish life, have been my whole life. The tragedy, and it is a tragedy, the tragedy in Jewish life is the abandonment of Judaism as the source of most Jews' values. By the way, this is true for vast numbers of Christians. This is not just a Jewish problem. Christians who leave Christianity and take on left-wing substitutes, feminism, environmentalism, all the other isms, the secular isms that substitute for Judaism and Christianity. They're substitute secular religions. I don't know, there's really nothing. The Jews have to work on themselves. I don't know really what conservatives can do. It's so obvious who is better for Israel, for example, but increasing numbers of Jews don't give a damn about Israel. They went to universities that crap on Israel, and they have imbibed that attitude. So even arguing, you know, the left isn't good for Israel anywhere on earth will mean nothing because they're leftists before they're pro-Israel. They're leftists before they're Jews, or they equate leftism and Judaism. Just as, by the way, many mainstream Protestants do, and in my opinion, tragically, to a large extent, to a dominant extent, the Pope of the Catholic Church does. This is not a just uniquely Jewish problem. Thank you. Yep.
Good morning, Mr. Prager.
Hi.
It was a privilege to hear you speak. My name is Nathaniel Lamb, and I attend The Ohio State University. And you joked earlier that you...
Why don't you lift the mic? Just you're too tall for it. So just lift it out of the holder, if you could, like the other guy. Maybe everybody gets it. Hand hold it and put it near your mouth. Great.
Awesome. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Awesome. All right. So anyway, you joked earlier that liberal was printed on your birth certificate.
Yes.
And I understand that the parties have evolved somewhat since then. But what marked your transition into such an outspoken conservative?
I am still a liberal. But that's why I'm called a conservative. I hold every liberal value I held when I was young, and every single one of them is now held by conservatives, like race blind. Race blind was a liberal belief, fundamental liberal belief. The left has taken over the word liberal, but that's a hijacking. The left has nothing in common with liberalism on any issue. FDR, was FDR a liberal? okay? Franklin D. Roosevelt, it's before my time, but we're allowed to read history. And FDR constantly spoke about the battle to save Western civilization. He even said often Christian civilization. President Trump went to Warsaw, said that we have to fight to preserve Western civilization. And do you know what the New York Times, the Washington Post, and the entire left said? It was a dog whistle to white supremacists. That was universally believed on the left, that to say we need to preserve Western civilization is a code word for white racism. Whereas liberals believed deeply in saving Western civilization. If you understand left has nothing to do with liberal, everything becomes much clearer in the United States.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Does that mean everybody left because there's one time for one more? Is that right? Thank you. Do you really know, or you just knew I was hunting for an answer? Okay, fine. Yes.
Hello, Mr. Prager. Someone on YAF staff earlier said to refer to you as Denny P, so that's what I'm going to do moving forward, especially with your rhyme of six herb. My question to you is, earlier you mentioned the act as if you're happy and it'll help you become happy. And a lot of the people in this room that I've talked to spoke about how in high school they were kind of introduced to politics via atheism, and then later they find faith again. And do you believe that that's a way to find faith, is acting as if you have it until it kind of becomes a part of your own identity?
Did somebody set you up? Because I couldn't have asked for a better question. Yes, everything in life is a choice. Abraham Lincoln, who could have been chronically depressed, he was married to a manic depressive woman, he lost his beloved sons, his whole country was tearing itself apart in a civil war, everything was shattered in his life. And Lincoln said, "We are as happy as we decide to be." You decide everything. I decided at a given point I would live as if there is a God. No one can prove it to me, no one can disprove it. But the existential, emotional, communal, moral benefits of a religious life so dwarf the shallowness of a secular life that I made that choice. It was the greatest choice I ever made. And by the way, I'll end then on telling you where I made the choice. In graduate school at Columbia University. And you could look it up, how I found God at Columbia. It's on the internet. Everything about me and everything that is not about me is on the internet. But you could check out that article, and this is what happened. And it sounds but like I made it up, and I swear before God this is how it happened. I was walking around Columbia, and I was totally confused. I was being taught by intelligent people, and I knew I was being taught mostly nonsense. I was taught men and women are basically the same. I was taught that the United States and the Soviet Union were equally responsible for the Cold War. It was just one foolish idea after another by very bright people. And so all of a sudden, and it's the only time I ever had an epiphany, not a theophany. Theophany means God appears. God has never appeared to me. But I had an epiphany, a realization of momentous significance. All of a sudden, a phrase that I had said as a child in first and second grade every day in yeshiva, in my religious classes, we said this phrase from the Psalms in Hebrew, Reshit Chochma Yirat Adonai. And we just say it, was just part of the rote prayer, which means wisdom begins with fear of God. And that was it. And I realized, of course there's no wisdom at Columbia. There's no God at Columbia. I have 15-year-olds call my show, and they have more wisdom than my professors at Columbia did. They don't have more knowledge, but they have more wisdom. And there's only one reason. I always ask them, are you religious? Are you growing up in a religious home? And in every single case of this 13-year-old, 15-year-old who sounds wise, yes. That's where I got my wisdom, from my Torah, from the first five books of the Bible and the rest of the Bible. But the Bible is regarded as drivel. by your universities. Lincoln died, there was a book on his night table, and he didn't go to church often. It was the Bible. Everything has changed in that sense for the worse. So yes, I made that decision, and aside from deciding to marry the woman I married to, it was the best decision I ever made. Thank you for having me. I always love being with you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks a million. Thank you.